Like the construction of the arch, St. Louis has been two pillars fighting to come together into one united region. The greater area of St. Louis, a confederated system of 91 municipalities, has led to extreme socioeconomic and racial segregation. This ongoing political fragmentation has fostered a more segregated society. The separation of schools and tax districts has had a large effect on the dispersion of funds that each school receives, influencing socioeconomic separation. The discouraged desegregation of the private housing market has also pioneered racial separation at the realty level as well.
First of all, St. Louis metropolitan area has historically been segregated for reasons that came out of the fact that we, on the Missouri side, were a slave state, and even though we stayed with the Union, slavery was practiced here, and then following the Civil War, segregation was fully in place, both residential and public education. One of the consequences of having a large number of municipalities is that if you also have, as a separate phenomenon, segregation by class, rich people living in one part of the area, middle income in another, and low income in still another, then if you incorporate each, the rich in their own municipalities, the middle income in their own, the low income in their own, then you have disparity of resources, sharp disparity of resources, for both local government services as well as things like public education.
It all started when the African American population in St. Louis began to rise. The whites were faced with a dilemma. Do they stay or do they leave? During this time between the 1940s and 1950s, civil rights were a prominent issue and there was tension between whites and blacks. This tension led to a divide which in turn led to white flight. With whites moving out of the city to surrounding suburban areas, the African American population was forced into isolation in the north side of St. Louis. This isolation was accomplished and enforced in a variety of ways, including some private and public strategies of exclusion overlapped and reinforced by one another.
In the 19th century, well into the 20th century, even towards the end of the 20th century, the reason that we were residentially segregated was whites insisting on it and capturing that in law. But now that we're in the 21st century, and what I'm about to say also applied to the last part of the 20th century, more of the reason that we are residentially segregated remain that way in 2013 is not because of laws requiring it, but because that the individual preferences result in that.
The total population of the city of St. Louis peaked at 850,000 in 1950. With whites moving into the county, the city's population dropped to 350,000 by the late 1990s. When the 20th century began, there were more than 10 city residents for every county resident inhabitant. Towards its end, there were about 3 countyans for every city dweller.
I think fragmented government is a problem when we think of it as fragmented. I mean, when you think about the word fragmented, it means disparate pieces. And I think we should be thinking again about our educational system, our housing stock, our economy, the fact that our population has not grown in this region over a decade, that we are just flat and regions around us are thriving and growing, I think is a major concern for our St. Louis metropolitan region.
The idea that St. Louis is fragmented by design is based off the system of government in which St. Louis consists of. This fragmentation is implemented with the intent of creating choice rather than chaos. If there were only one government for an entire metropolitan region, there would be equal levels of public services in each and every neighborhood within the area.
St. Louis benefits from having many different local governments and many different local school districts in the sense that it provides both accessibility, control that's close, that you feel comfortable with. It also provides a lot of options so that not all local governments are alike, not all school districts are alike in terms of their curricula and the way in which they provide public education.
This also means one police force with its distinctive patrolling style, one school district with its particular curricular approach, one parks and recreation department with its set of leisure preferences, and so forth.
On the other hand, if you wiped away all of those boundaries, you still would have the segregation by residence, class segregation, and you would still have some remnants of inequities even without the force or the structure of the local government or the school district being in play.
In theory, having one governmental influence of a region sounded fine, but it could cause people to fret being that they are under one government for an entire metropolitan area. This fragmented government is proving to have positive and negative effects on the community. However, the positives may not outweigh the negatives. The multiplicity of local government has caused separation at a racial, social, and economic level.
I think absolutely our fragmented government structure has led and has in many ways sustained segregation. It is in our community a real sort of heart and head issue. I think from the heart, most people don't like the fact that we are known as a community that is highly segregated. I think that when you think about generations, people want to often live in communities where they were brought up and they know that community, they know the housing stock, they like the fact that they know the alder person or the mayor or the police, and so there's this sort of comfort. On the other hand, there is, I think, this desperation for some.
The high levels of municipal zoning taking place has created unequal opportunities amongst residents that reside in parts of the city. To help with the city's decline, urban renewal was introduced. This program was created to redevelop land in areas of moderate to high density urban land use. Renewal has had both its successes and its failures. Unfortunately for St. Louis, this program did not pan out as it took St. Louis right back to the declining state of before. The clearest example of the urban renewal failure can be seen at the dividing line between North and South Del Mar. The North of Del Mar consists of impoverished homes and abandoned buildings caused by a combination of the decline of industrial job opportunities, low property value, and concentrated poverty. With decreasing tax revenue and public services, African Americans migrated into North St. Louis due to the cheap housing market and decision to self-segregate.
The politics and the governmental structure reflect our values rather than shape our values. So the reason that we have the structure that we do have, again, is because we don't necessarily want to be living with a wide, diverse set of individuals. We want to be living with people who share whatever values we have.
Redlining, a common market strategy, used by banks in the 1960s and 1970s, took place and prevented African Americans from obtaining bank loans to improve their homes, as well as preventing them from moving westward. Banks would mark a red line on a map to delineate where they would not invest. This created a perception that neighborhoods were in decline, and in time, the perception became a reality. On the other hand, the south of Del Mar consisted of predominantly white homeowners who took advantage of the now affordable, high-quality homes located near prestigious institutions such as Washington University. A key factor of whites choosing to stay was due to the turning point of white flight.
You know, often I wonder, I think about the role that media plays in segregation because, you know, you read the newspaper, you hear the radio, you watch television, and they always tell you what area of the region this person lives in, this crime is happening, how old the person is, what color skin the person has. And in many ways, that's just feeding into these stereotypes that some people have.
In the minds of many, urban blight was not accidental, but was the result of deliberate activity by the real estate, financial institutions, and insurance companies. St. Louis is now faced with how can it become equal on a socioeconomic level. Currently, in the year 2013, it is not clear whether or not there is even support for desegregation or the movement towards integration at the residential level. If we look at the individual preferences within each ethnicity, the pattern leans towards people wanting to live within a similar ethnic neighborhood rather than an integrated one.
For a majority of residents of the St. Louis area within each race, whites want to live in neighborhoods that are predominantly, not exclusively white, but predominantly white. African Americans want to live in neighborhoods that have a substantial number of African Americans in the population. So there's a desire to be comfortable, and comfort is defined by a majority of Americans, or at least a majority of St. Louisans, is having people, a lot of them, of your race in your neighborhood.
In order for integration to occur in a nation that prizes liberty, people must be willing to live in an integrated setting, and if that doesn't take place, then St. Louis will continue to have segregated communities.
Like I'm on my last go round. If I'm feeling tomorrow like I feel today. Yes, feeling tomorrow like I feel today. I'm gonna pack my trunk and make my getaway. Say, St. Louis woman,